Today we'll be reading Light and Shadow from the Star Wars Adventure Journal by Paul Danner. Light and Shadow, Part 1. The Jedi who fall are the most dangerous of all. Line from a children's rhyme. Dray watched the bright red star disappear into the darkness of the horizon. His thoughts were a jumbled mass, and as the sun vanished, so did his hope of untangling these chaotic feelings. It was always worse at night, when he had nothing to do but stare up at the endless expanse of black sky and consider his plight. He had come to this world at the edge of the galactic frontier to try and salvage his very soul. The Republic's astrogation survey team had yet to explore the planet, so it had no designation. Since he made the discovery, Dray figured he should also give his new home a name. He called it Vigil. At first, the verdant forest planet seemed like a perfect place for introspection and healing. However, its pastoral beauty only caused Dray more pain as he came to a terrible realization. The idyllic serenity of the environment served as a daily reminder that such tranquility would never again be his. In the past, Dray had been the master of his emotions, but peace was now merely a fleeting dream. He fled civilized space in order to escape his troubles, but there was never any escape, no matter where he went, not even on Vigil. Dray often contemplated leaving, but to go where? He would merely be hunted down as he was before, and Dray was tired of running. So he remained on the planet, both as paradise and perdition. He stretched out a tentative hand like an infant reaching for its mother. Almost immediately, he experienced the tingling sensation of the Force surging around his fingertips. A small chill touched the base of his spine with the knowing caress of an old lover. Dray sighed and rested himself in the small clearing under a canopy of wide-leaf arcosia trees. The delicately sweet smell of the foliage drifted through his nostrils, and he drank in the aroma. Sitting cross-legged with his hands folded across his lap, Dray closed his eyes. The scent of arcosia swept into his lungs. He quieted himself until all that remained was the sound of his own breath. Dray opened himself up to the harmony of nature. The shrill calls of the prism wings taking flight conjured up a breathtaking image of the brightly colored birds streaking a rainbow through the sky. He concentrated on distinguishing between the soft hoots of the other avians, the snuffling cries resounding from 100 species of animals, and the tinny warbles of the bewildering array of insects. His breathing became slower, more exact, falling into an almost lulling rhythm. Dray tried to remember the meditative exercises taught to him by his master, Venma Teral. He had not been able to call upon them in a very long time, since... A sharp pain nearly cut through his concentration, twisting like a vibroblade in his gut. He would never forget that day. His meditation had come to an abrupt end when Yeri's Thareem burst into the botanical garden. The Vulcan Jedi adept was demanding answers, and Dray had none to give his friend. Dray's face twitched as he relived the awful moment. Thareem was beyond reason, attempting to kill Dray, but that hardly mattered. Thareem knew the truth, and therefore had to die. For what? A familiar voice demanded to know. Dray could not identify it, so for the moment he ignored it. Dray could still hear the clash of their lightsabers, feel the haft of his weapon vibrate in his hand, smell the horrid cauterization of flesh. Then he was standing over the body of one of his closest friends. Dray could still see the terrible, empty look on the Vulcan's face. Those dark eyes like dull transparisteel, accusing Dray of betrayal long after Thareem had stopped breathing. It was the first Jedi that Dray had killed. It would not be the last. Other memories began to flood his mind, threatening to disrupt his contemplation. Dray took a cleansing breath, let go his focus, cleared his thoughts. He tried again, and suddenly heard the words of his master echoing through his head.
Try, and you will always fail. Success is not a goal. It is a conscious decision.
Dray increased his concentration. The characteristic sounds of his adopted planet fell away as he searched for something else. Sweat beaded on his forehead, matting his hair, and dripping down his back in icy rivulets. He released his awareness of the physical body and grasped for something greater. For a moment, Dray feared the ability was lost to him. No. Wait. There. He heard it, hushed at first, but growing ever stronger. The heartbeat of his new home. The resonant geothermal pulse that warmed the cold rock. Dray slowly timed his own heartbeat to Vigil's, and they became as one. The crude vessel of the body could no longer contain his spirit. Dray did not fully abandon his physical form, but embraced it into the whole of his being and moved beyond, into nature. He was the rocks, the trees, the animals, the lakes, the dirt, the world. It was not enough. He reached for the stars above, into the galaxy that surrounded him, into the very heart of the Force. He felt his entire conscious being lifted into a place that words could never describe. His body was engulfed in flame, and then dipped into a vast ocean of ice. He continued to rise, and as he did, he felt his mind begin to open. It could not fully encompass what he was experiencing, but he knew he was about to reach a plateau. The most beautiful woman in the galaxy was wrapping him in her arms, and pulling him higher and higher. Something abruptly stopped his ascension. He heard the rumblings first, the terrible thunder emanating from great storm clouds clearing the horizon. Then came the lightning, unnaturally violent and unerringly vicious. The winds roared with fury, and nothing could stand against them. The great storm tore at the land mercilessly, striking at Dre's own heart. The sky that had borne him aloft suddenly released him. Dre found himself falling. Falling. A coldness like he had never felt swept over him, chilling his breath even in the temperate clime of Vigil's forests. The storm was coming for him, fueled by fear, rage, hatred. Dre braced himself but knew there was no hope of surviving the onslaught. Then came thunder like no other, and Dre thought it was the first strike of the dark side storm. The anticipated attack never arrived. And Dre realized the jarring sound was not a manifestation of the Force after all. It was reality. His eyes snapped open and the trance was lost. The dreadful storm was gone as quickly as it had arrived. Dre immediately saw the streaking arc of light cutting through the sky, like a falling star, only much closer. Whatever the object was, it had just entered the atmosphere, burning as bright as any sun. It seemed to take forever to complete its descent. The flaring object disappeared momentarily behind the tree line, and Dre felt the coldness of a metallic craft sheltering three life forms. He could feel the vital pulse of each being, and for an awful moment, their emotions were also his to experience. Fear. Hopelessness. Despair. A familiar tingle rippled down Dre's body as the dark side began to feed. Suddenly, there was an explosion so great, Dre felt it from over a mile away. The ground shook as if racked by a rampaging herd of angry bantha. Dre lost his footing and rode the rest of the aftershocks flat on his back. All was silent once more. Dre was already up and running. He stumbled through the last few meters of tangled underbrush, nearly landing headfirst in the impact trench that stretched across the valley. Dre followed the track, running parallel to it, and estimated the size of the ship that may have caused the sizable furrow. His heart trip-hammered inside his chest as he closed in on the unnatural crater that yawned like an open wound. He skidded to a halt at the lip of the smoldering abyss and surveyed the situation. The vessel was some sort of scout craft, too small to be a freighter, and not enough armor or weapons to be a fighter. The ship had split into two large sections, and each half was a raging inferno. Dre slowly descended the dirt mound and moved toward the fiery remains, keeping one arm protectively over his face. He made his way over the minefield of flaming debris to what he guessed was the cockpit. He could see two bodies completely engulfed. For their sake, Dre hoped they died on impact. As sweat poured off him like rain, he carefully began moving away from the blazing inferno. He wasn't sure what stopped him, whether it was a slight tremor in the Force, or a faint, plaintive cry. Maybe it was neither, just his imagination riled by his failed attempt at a meditative trance. Whatever the cause, something drew him back to the downed craft. He stepped closer to the other half of the broken ship and peered into the conflagration. That's when he saw her, a young girl no more than 7 years old. Her blonde hair was soaked with perspiration, her eyes wild with fear. The girl's mouth moved again and again, though Dray couldn't make out what she was saying. He could get no closer than a few meters because of the raging wall of fire. The girl could not come to him. Her right leg was trapped under a large cylindrical power coupler.
"Can you hear me?" Dray called out to her.
The girl did not answer him. All of her attention was focused on the cockpit.
"Mommy! Daddy!"
Tears rolled down her cheeks as she cried out again.
"Help me!"
"I'm trying," Dray said under his breath.
He waved his arms at her, hoping her eyes would at least track the motion.
"Look at me, princess."
She finally did. The girl was struggling to free her leg, but succeeding only in getting the limb wedged further.
"Listen, don't try to move, okay?"
Time was slipping away quickly, as measured by the metallic groans of the ship's superstructure as it tried to hold itself together. It was a futile battle against a relentless foe. Dray had to make a decision, and quickly.
"I'm going to help you. Just hang on."
He cleared his mind and concentrated on the fiery barrier that stood between himself and the girl. Holding his arms in front of him, Dray started forward like a sleepwalker stumbling through a dream. Sensing a new victim, the flames licked at his hands, his face, his clothing, but Dray did not feel the blazing tendrils trying to coil around him. His entire body shimmered as he absorbed the intense heat and walked through the boiling barrier as if it were a waterfall. Dray emerged unscathed on the other side, in the broken aft of the ship. The girl was staring at him now with perceptive hazel pupils. The fear had vanished, replaced by confusion. He prepared to manipulate the force again, this time to lift the heavy cylinder off the girl's leg. Dray wasn't sure why, but instead found himself reaching down to grasp the heavy machinery. He bent his legs and lifted for all he was worth. The cylinder screeched in annoyance at being disturbed, reluctant to release its grip, but with a final grunt of exertion, Dray managed to free the girl from her makeshift prison. As Dray quickly wiped the sweat from his forehead, he considered his actions. The first method would have been easier, but an unnecessary reliance on the force to do something just as easily accomplished with a little sweat. He had a sudden fleeting image of depraved Sith overlords sitting on their thrones, using the force to attend to their every insignificant need. Some were so bloated from years of inactivity, their limbs had all but atrophied. A shrill whine from above banished the disturbing imagery from Dray's mind. The roof of the craft was about to give way and land on their heads. Dray carefully scooped up the girl in his arms, surprised by how little she weighed. He pressed her small face against the front of his sweat-soaked tunic. Turning away from the expanding heart of the blaze, Dray gathered the force to shield them both from the smothering heat. Building up ahead of speed, Dray lunged clear of the sizzling mess, just as the scorched metal finally collapsed into itself. His thighs ached from the strain of keeping his body balanced as it ascended the steep pit, but his arms were otherwise occupied. Dray continued running in order to escape the lingering clouds of acrid smoke drifting lazily from the abyss. His legs gave way soon after and he stumbled to his knees. He placed the girl down on the cool grass and felt his chest heaving. Dray had inhaled more than his share of the foul fumes, and his body thudded to the ground, racked by a violent coughing spasm. After what seemed to be an eternity, Dray finally took a cleansing breath. He greedily drank in another, then another, until his respiration was once again a process free of pain. Dray checked on the little girl, and to his surprise, found her staring right at him. He unconsciously shuddered. No, more like she was looking through him. Those blue-green eyes, wise beyond their tender years, drilled into him like a plasma cutter.
"I think you're evil," she said matter-of-factly. "Usually, I can tell, but not with you."
She paused for a moment, then frowned.
"You saved me. How come?"
Dray's mouth opened and then closed as a million thoughts battled for dominance in his head. The girl abruptly turned away, staring back at the flaming wreckage.
"I'm doing it again. My mama says sometimes I ask too many questions and hurt people's feelings. For the first time, she actually sounded like a frightened child.
She's dead now. So is my daddy.
The girl looked back over at him, tears pouring from her eyes. Before he knew it, her small hands were wrapped around him, and his tunic was wet with her sobs. Dray felt her tiny body shuddering uncontrollably against him, and suddenly he had difficulty swallowing as his throat tightened in sympathy. He took in a long breath through his nose, quelling the surging emotions. Dray desperately wanted to tell her everything would be okay, but could not. That would be a terrible lie.
"I'm sorry," he whispered,
but the comforting words sounded hollow in his own ears. They could never be enough to ease such tremendous pain.
"I'm sorry," he said again, and held her tightly until she was all cried out.
Dre wasn't sure when she finally fell asleep, but he was near exhaustion as he carried her back to his campsite. He sat a few feet away watching her curled up in his bedroll, sleeping soundly considering the nightmare she had just survived. Before he knew it, dawn had crept over his shoulder. The sentry duty wasn't really necessary. There weren't any predators on Vigil that could pose much of a threat to him, but he performed it anyway. As he kept watch over the girl, Dre realized why the girl had such an odd affectation about her. There was a great concentration of the force held within that small frame, yet so untamed and unharnessed, he didn't quite sense at first. But now he could not help but feel it, drawing him like a homing beacon. An idea struck him, and he acted upon it before he could even debate the merits or flaws. He focused on the sleeping form in front of him, summoning up his considerable abilities. As gently as he could, Dre reached out to her mind, trying to open her thoughts to him. Tentatively, he began to probe the girl's consciousness, a normally slow process made almost interminable due to his circumspect manner. Bracing himself, Dre prepared to enter her deep subconscious. That was where a force-sensitive being maintained a protective barrier that would prevent another force wielder from penetrating his or her inner mind. This powerful shield violently pushed back such an intruder. The stronger the push, the greater the being's strength in the force. It was a technique often used by Jedi Masters to sense the potential of their students. Dre centered himself and stepped across the threshold. It was as if someone had shot him out of a proton torpedo launcher, straight into the heart of a supernova. Dre let out a scream so high-pitched, his own ears could barely hear it as he was flung through the verdant forests of Vigil. He cut a green swath through the underbrush, his body smashing tree branches to splinters. His stomach heaved as his flight lasted impossibly long before coming to a jarring end in a small lake. Dre landed with a hearty splash in the icy water, nearly half a mile away from his camp. He floated there in the water, contemplating what he had just experienced. He wasn't sure how much time had passed before he noticed the girl standing at the edge of the lake. Her hair was a morning jumble, and she stifled a yawn with a hand as she stared at him in bewilderment.
"Are you okay?"
Dre's head was pounding hard, the rhythm beating out a single word that played in his mind over and over.
"Incredible." "What's your name?" he asked her over lunch.
It wasn't the most nutritious meal, but he had very little left in the way of prepackaged, healthy rations. He did his best to offer her a good mix of berries, meat, and an assortment of desiccated victuals ready to eat. Those little silver bags stamped with the seal of the Republic were the bane of every soldier, but would always do in a pinch.
"Nova," she finally replied. "My name is Nova."
"That's very pretty," he smiled at her,
but she kept a neutral expression.
"Thank you."
She chewed thoughtfully on a tranglo berry.
"I like this place. It reminds me of my aunt's garden, only bigger."
Her eyes wandered for a moment before settling on him.
"Why are you here?"
"You know, you can call me Leon if you'd like."
She nodded and said,
"Did you come here because of your heart?"
Dre arched an eyebrow, studying the girl.
"My heart?"
"I can feel it. I think it weighs more than my daddy's ship."
A shadow passed across her face for a moment,
and Dray thought she was about to start sobbing again. Surprisingly, she did not.
"That's why I thought you were evil at first, because of the things you did."
The shadow was back, only more like a storm cloud now, born of intense concentration.
"Bad things."
"I..." The words died on his lips. "How could she know?" he thought to himself.
"I know because you told me, Leon. Only I don't think you meant to, but it was there."
She pointed a small finger at his chest, right toward the space his physical heart occupied, but knew that wasn't exactly what she was referring to. Dray kneeled down next to her.
"I think you have a very special gift, Nova. Has anyone ever told you that?"
The girl nodded slowly, but her attention was no longer directed at him. Her eyes widened, and he felt a twinge of fear run through her. A moment later, he knew why, as a subtle pulse vibrated through the Force. Nova sensed them just before he did, and she had no formal training.
"Amazing," he thought as he spun a graceful circle.
Midway through the revolution, his lightsaber burst to life with a soothing hum. The golden blade shimmered like a mirage under the afternoon glare, sending ripples of heat down his body. Two beings emerged from the thick foliage, both dressed in midnight blue jumpsuits. They advanced with the sinuous gait of true predators. Their movements were mirrored in uncanny unison, and Dray noticed an unmistakable resemblance. The intruders were brother and sister, probably twins. The only appreciable difference was hair length. His was shorn and shaven, while hers was a flowing ebony jungle. Both radiated the icy heat of the dark side. Dray could smell it on them with the bittersweet piquancy of a finely aged roque wine. The male was the weaker of the two, and neither one alone could overpower him. Working together, however, that was a different story altogether. At the moment, however, they were solely intent on Nova.
"They're evil,"
Nova said to Dray, her voice strong and assured. The twins continued to eye the girl, almost hungrily. Dray was summarily ignored. Considering he was the self-appointed caretaker of the world they were currently trespassing upon, Dray felt that was just plain rude.
"Excuse me," Dray said and casually switched off his lightsaber.
He nearly smiled as he noted their confusion. Their eyes danced over him, and he could feel the soft murmurs of their minds touching his, prying for information. He allowed them to remain long enough to sense his formidable power, and then banished them with but a thought. The male, Zash was his name, spoke first.
"You are Jedi."
"But not Jedi,"
his sister said, Syndra's head cocked slightly as if unsure of how to proceed. Dray studied the adepts for a few moments, deciding on the best course of action.
"You are observant," Dray finally said, "but not too smart."
He waved his hand as if dismissing them from his presence.
"Take what you will from the wreckage of the ship, and then be gone from my home."
The twins exchanged a rapacious look, somewhere between a smile and a snarl, and then Syndra began to laugh. It was an ugly sound full of cruelty.
"Ha ha ha ha! Our master wishes otherwise. The girl will come with us."
Her face became serious, the coldness of her visage hardening her beauty.
"Stand aside, or die."
"Big words from little adepts. You are both weak."
Dray favored the twins with a hollow smile and a dangerous hiss.
"I smell your fear."
Syndra started toward Dray, but her brother apparently wanted the honor.
"Leave him to me."
Without another word, the orange blade of Zash's lightsaber flashed into existence, and he launched into a furious attack. The first strike, though powerful, was a bit slow. Dray easily sidestepped and delivered a hard, open-handed slap to the back of his opponent's head. Zash rolled with the impact and quickly returned to his feet. The male adept was enraged and obviously intent on revenge. He drew back his saber and started to advance. Dray displayed the patient smile of a teacher whose student had just made a fool of himself. Dray winked at Zash, then reignited the golden lightsaber, swinging the hilt around at a leisurely pace. The gilded blade finally extended with a soft thrumming of energy. Outraged by Dray's show of disrespect, Zash lunged forward, leading in with a blinding flurry of strikes. Dray swiveled with practice ease, dodging each attack and countering with his own. The sabers clashed, sparks flying through the air. Zash pulled back and drove ahead with a quick slash toward Dray's throat. Dray twirled his blade, catching Zash mid-strike and spinning Zash's saber through his own momentum. The move spun the weapon right out of the twin's grasp. Unfortunately for Zash, his right hand was still attached to the handle. The severed appendage, clutching reflexively to the hilt, fell to the ground. As Zash stared mutely at the stump of his arm, Dray planted a boot in Zash's chest. The blow toppled the surprised adept, and he hit the ground stunned. Dray readied his lightsaber, but before he could finish the job, something caught his attention. The sound of Syndra igniting her own weapon. In mid-turn, Dray felt the tip of her blade bite into his back. He ignored the racking pain of his burned flesh, and quickly followed through on his counterstrike before Syndra could do any further damage. The strong parry drove her back, giving Dray some breathing room. She advanced slowly, the deep crimson blade held in a loose two-handed grip. The two combatants began to circle. Dray took a tentative swipe high to test her defenses. She countered easily. Syndra was quick, agile, and lithe. That wild mane of hair trailed behind her like a living thing. Syndra moved the lightsaber high overhead, the classic first position of attack. The girl was well trained indeed. Dray adopted a lateral stance, the classic answer. He wasn't exactly an amateur either. As expected, her blade arced through a downward strike. He parried with a sharply angled upthrust. Syndra absorbed his defense and moved into a counter parry that nearly disarmed him. Gold and crimson flashed through the night. They stepped back and circled again. Dray took the lead in the deadly dance, delivering an overhead strike that abruptly became a feint and quickly cut low. Syndra inverted her saber and blocked the attack, allowing the impact to direct her blade toward Dray's neck. He parried, driving the tip of her blade downward. She was ready for it, and their blades quickly locked together. The two warriors paused long enough to offer one another an almost perceptible nod, a grudging measure of respect. Again, they circled. Syndra unexpectedly launched into a blinding series of slashes. Dray was hard-pressed to block the flurry, but succeeded. Barely. Their last furious exchange left his chest aching for air, so he stepped back to momentarily catch his breath. It cost him. Instead of taking the opportunity to do the same, Syndra came at him like a mad howler beast. Dray found himself forced into an ungainly riposte that became useless when her vertical downstrike abruptly transformed into a wicked slash that opened his right shoulder. He winced in pain and stumbled away. Her eyes were glowing with hate, the fuel of the dark side. Dray could feel the power surging through her. He felt a familiar, desperate craving surging in his belly. The soft whisper that had controlled his life the last few years began its soft serenade. But it had no effect. He was not yet angry, and therefore his silky mistress could not help him. Syndra exploded into another series of fluid strikes that sent him reeling back. He carefully measured her attack pattern, and managed to catch her blade with the tip of his own. His unexpected parry forced her saber upwards, right where he wanted it. Dray attempted to sweep her left leg out from under her, a move that usually gave him the upper hand. But Syndra's reaction time was better than he expected. She dropped a hand from her saber, using it to block his extended leg. An instant later, she jabbed her other arm forward, using the haft of the weapon to smash Dray in the face. The blow split his lip and knocked him to the ground. Instinct and years of training allowed him to retain his hold on the saber, which he waved back and forth to ward off any further strikes. However, a follow-up attack was not forthcoming. She merely stood over a fallen opponent silently. Then she began to laugh. Dray gingerly touched a hand to his throbbing lip, though he already knew it was bleeding from the sour taste in his mouth. He stared at the crimson stain spreading across his fingertips, and his eyes narrowed to slits. Her incessant cackling continued, sending a tidal wave of heat washing through his body. Dray's insides boiled as if his body temperature had suddenly risen to a feverish degree. Dray heard the intimate whisper again. The silky voice grew louder, thundering in his ears and echoing through his brain as it infused his body with a burst of pure emotion. Anger. His heart raced as the raw fuel was quickly converted into energy. An ancient Corellian battle cry escaped from his lips, and Dray jumped to his feet, delivering a vicious two-handed swing powerful enough to split Syndra in two. Recognizing the danger, Syndra quickly brought her saber up and deflected the vicious strike just in time. She staggered under the weight of the brutal offensive and was forced a few steps backward. He shadowed her every move, rapidly closing the gap between them. Dray knew she had ceased her mocking laughter, but he could not get that terrible sound out of his head. All he wanted to do was kill her. What was so wrong with that, he pondered, knuckles white from his death grip on the lightsaber. Nothing, came the whispery voice, growing louder and lovelier by the moment. Nothing at all. Dray smiled, savoring the blood smeared across his lips. He craved more. Syndra saw it in his eyes, and it obviously frightened her. The tide of the battle had abruptly turned, and she was on the wrong end.
I had you beaten, she said in a whining voice.
Huh, never dwell on the past, Dray grinned, an unpleasant sight. If I were you, I'd be more concerned about your future, or lack thereof.
No.
Syndra was retreating as fast as possible, without turning her back on him.
Leon!
Nova's shrill call shook him out of the dark reverie. He was slightly disoriented, like someone startled out of deep slumber. Dray glanced back in time to see Zash charging. The wounded limb, severed below the forearm, was tucked down at the twin's side. Zash snarled as his remaining hand swung a lightsaber in the direction of Dray's head. With no time to turn, Dray lifted the blade up over his shoulder and then down again, successfully blocking Zash's strike. Unfortunately, it also left his front unprotected, a bad circumstance for Dray that Syndra immediately attempted to take full advantage of. She had withdrawn herself from saber range, but had a variety of other nasty tricks at her disposal. One hand shot forward, serving as a focal point for her power. Dray gasped for air as his heart began to constrict. He tumbled to his knees, the pain quickly becoming unbearable. Invisible claws tore mercilessly into his chest. Syndra's face twisted into a vile facade, and she hissed like a serpent. Her outstretched hand trembled as if she really held Dray's heart, gleefully digging in her nails to squeeze out every last drop of life. Zash stepped back, obediently waiting to deliver the killing blow. The lightsaber slipped from Dray's numb fingers and deactivated. He could not find his breath. His heart skipped, then faltered, and then stopped. His anger grew stronger. He inwardly called to the dark storm, begged for its providence. The kind mistress with the voice of whispery coils answered him. He could feel her silken breath tickle his ear. Dray opened himself to the blinding rage, always seething like a second skin under his flesh. The hate swirled to a single-minded maelstrom of rage, and the rage made him powerful. His fingertips jerked outward, and his fury erupted as crackling bolts of power. Force lightning streaked towards Syndra, enveloping her in a snare of electrical energy. She cried out from the depths of her being, and sunk to the ground as spidery lances snapped voraciously around her. Dray's heart jumped to life, the chilling sensation turned to fire, and he was free. Zash had been watching in shock as his sister writhed in the dirt, so he was late in delivering the strike that a moment ago would have beheaded Dray. It would be his final mistake. Dray dropped flat on his back to dodge Zash's belated assault. As the high swing passed harmlessly above, Dray twisted his head around and gestured at his attacker. Zash flew nearly 100 feet before slamming into the trunk of a huge Arcosia tree with a resounding crunch. The body slid to the ground and, if there was any doubt from the impact, Syndra's shriek told Dray all he needed to know. The uncanny link all twins seemed to share had been severed like a string. Zash was dead. Renewed strength coursed through Dray, power given life by the anger that still burned within. He needed only flick his wrist, and the golden saber flew to him, igniting with a joyous burst. Four quick strides brought him to Syndra, and he watched impassively as her body continued to convulse. Tiny electric charges crackled through her clouded eyes, across the cavern of her open mouth, and dancing down the rest of her body. Dray raised the saber to finish it. A voice, strong and sure, demanded to be heard. Tyrall.
A Jedi does not kill an unarmed foe.
The Velvet Whisper answered, and Dray echoed the words.
True.
He brought the blade down, and Syndra's laughter finally stopped.
But I am no longer a Jedi.
The breeze died away, and then there was only silence. Dray turned from the carnage and saw Nova's face, a mask of absolute horror. He had a resurgence of pain in his heart for a moment, but it disappeared as quickly as it arrived. The rage was also gone, scattered like dust in a hurricane. He was just Dray, breathing heavily and drenched in sweat. He was tired, hurt, and aching all over. But there was something else, too. Something he had not felt in a long time. Shame. He opened his mouth to explain, to say something, but Nova was already sprinting away into the forest. He started to give chase, then realized he was too weak. Exhaustion had set in with frightening speed. Drained physically and emotionally, Dray slipped down to his knees. He glanced warily at the bodies, at the bloodshed he had wrought. The twins shouldn't have come here, he rationalized, and the girl was not his responsibility. The tingling whisper became his own voice. Of course not. Why bother going after her?
Why?
He asked again, this time aloud. He received no answer. Part 2 will continue next time.